deal with airplane peanuts.
I do not think that Norm would want to hear anything sentimental, but I would like to say a few of my favorite things that I heard Norm say, that I was lucky enough to hear Norm say over the years. I started at SNL in 2001, and I remember one time Norm walked back into the studio to visit. I don't remember how old his son was at the time, but his son was young, and someone said, "Hey, Norm, how's being a dad?" And he said, "It's going great. Still no abductions." That's the first thing I ever heard him say in person.
Have you hung out with him?
Yeah.
I've never hung out with him.
I hung out with him twice accidentally on two separate occasions.
The airplane.
On planes. I told you about it, right?
I heard they are the one of them.
It
and he was smoking.
Yeah. Once in Vancouver and once somewhere else. And the last one, he was talking about, yeah, I quit smoking. He was telling me how he quit smoking. Yeah, it was hard. It was really hard to quit. And I did it. And, you know, fucking smoke, it's terrible for you. So we land. He walks as fast as he can off the plane right into one of those stores and buys a pack of cigarettes. And he's opening up it and he's got one in his mouth as he's out the door.
He went off for an hour about how it's terrible for you. He's so glad he's out over it.
So I'm outside with him. I go, "What are you doing? I thought you quit smoking." He goes, "Yeah, but all that fucking talking about it, I wanted a cigarette."
So was he being funny or was he just a weirdo?
No. He was just a genius.
I mean, I think, right? Didn't he drive? Just invited people to go do tennis and stuff. So he'd be like, "Pick me up on the way."
His brain was just wired different.
Yeah.
It was just wired different all the time.
I also forget how poetic he is.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't know him that well in the 90s. And then when my dad died, I had to do a movie with Norm. And I tried everything to get out of that movie because I was inconsolable. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't get out of it. And working with him was the greatest thing that ever happened to me. It was like he was the right guy at the right time. I was inconsolable.
Did he talk to you about your dad a lot? Or what did he do?
Never came up.
Uh-huh.
He just made me laugh.
Yeah, right.
He just... You know, and it was, you know, wistful and musing. And you know, Norm is, he never knew he was setting something up or not. We were just hanging out, and all of a sudden it'd be like this punchline out of nowhere. But it started to become like a work was like a church I go to. Like, I couldn't wait to get to work and just hang around this guy. And I knew he was special.
Yeah.
And I've known people for years and years that didn't make me laugh as much as he did in that 8 or 10 weeks. So he's like a real special person to me. And the way he's funny, I just never seen someone get at it like that.
Norm Macdonald, you'd hang out with him and you'd get whatever he said to you, but then he'd disappear.
Right.
And he wasn't on podcasts. He wasn't on fucking Instagram.
I know. And I had a couple... ins to try to have him on a few times
on the podcast.
Yeah. I mean, it wasn't like progressing, but I was like, I remember going like, I should ask this guy.
Oh yeah,
that kind of stuff.
I had an opportunity to have him on.
Did you just fart?
Yeah, I did, and I couldn't. By the way, probably my biggest regret is that I didn't spend more time like chasing my heroes, meaning like hanging out with the people or like going like, "Hey, I'd love to open for you" or something.
I
would have loved to have had more interactions with Norm. And the ones I had, I think, are great. Same with Bob Saget.
I want to talk about Norm, Bob, because I know that you love Norm, and I fucking love Norm. I think Norm's maybe an American treasure.
He is one of the funniest people alive, I think.
Ever.
Yeah. And Norm is regarded by most funny people to be one of the funnier people alive. And we've had some real interesting shit happen together. It's, I made Dirty Work, so that's a year with Norm Macdonald.
Yeah.
And it's like, Entertainment Tonight was there while I was directing it. And for the cameras, he goes, I'm whispering in his ear some stuff, giving him some notes. He goes, "Why am I listening to the dad from Full House? Why am I taking direction from the video guy?"
And Bob Saget directed this.
Yeah, right? Well, you know, there's bad news and everything.
This is the first time me touring with a star.
Okay.
We go to the airport and people are like, "Oh my God, you're Norm Macdonald." I'm like, wow, this is everywhere we went. "Oh my God, you're Norm Macdonald." We show up at the university. He's like, "I got to go golfing with the fucking governor tomorrow. They made me fucking golf." Fucking governor?
Yeah, what is that game where you fucking hit the
right?
thing?
So I'm like, he's with a governor. Yeah. This is huge. Who gets to say that? So I'm it's me, Daryl Hammond, and him.
And you all, both you guys went?
We're okay, on the sorry. Gig.
Okay, okay.
We're going out. He's
Daryl
telling us.
Daryl Hammond, yes.
And so we get to the gig and is packed. And they go, now listen, there's kids here and there's students and alum and the dean and all these people here. So
oh, that's the worst.
They're like, yeah, clean. I get it. No worries. I go, we're in Sunday Light. He goes, that's why we got you guys, because you're used to live TV. So Daryl goes up first, does his 20 minutes, does impressions, does his comedy. Hilarious.
Mm-hmm.
I go up, do my 20, feel great, crush it. Norm goes up. I'm not even exaggerating. The first thing he says, he goes up, he goes, look, it's like, I'm preparing. I'm like, this is going to launch my career. Are you kidding me? This is going to be huge. I'm going to be all. He goes, fucking, where the fuck are we? First person to even curse. Right? I went, oh, shit, he cursed. And he goes, so if you're gay, would you rather be the ass guy? Or the dick guy? This is what he starts off with. So I go, Daryl, you gotta come see this. Yeah, and he's going, and he won't stop. He's like,
Daryl's just being depressed in the back.
Because if you're the ass guy, why do you want to be the ass guy? First of all, he's going on. People are grabbing their kids, running up the aisle. I never saw a place clear out. It looked like a fire alarm was going off. But the college students were staying, and they were howling with laughter. And he, one thing, and then in the middle, after about 15 minutes, he goes, Jesus Christ, what do you want? Are you fucking airplane jokes? You want fucking 7-Eleven jokes? Hey, Jesus Christ, fuck out of here. So the next day, in the paper, USA Today or the Gazette, like, Norm McDonald's out.
Wow.
Governor wants him out of the state.
Governor wants him.
Get out of my state.
I just was laughing with Spade about how, remember when Spade did Norm's Netflix show?
Yeah.
And Norm's is doing, it's like, just like this. And he goes, and we'll be right back. And the cameras are rolling. And Spade's like, just like, you cut to commercial. He's like, yeah, we just got to do a commercial real quick. And then he just waited. He's like, and we're back. And Spade's like, was that real? And he's fucking with
him. That was, by the way.
It's so funny, dude.
Yeah.
It's so funny.
Dude.
My favorite host, you know, they all mean something different. Let me tell you something. I'll tell you what's true about this hat. Do you go to commercials?
Yeah.
Oh, you have to go to commercial? I see some signs. Do you want to do it now?
We'll be back.
Oh, yeah. And we'll talk
and
about
we'll
my
hear...
hat when I get back. We'll be back after we mop ourselves.
He's just one of those guys who describes the most basic shit that we all know, but it's funny when because he points it out. Like, his Letterman set, the last Letterman, when he goes, Germany decided to attack the world, you know? And you're like, that's so true. And then he goes, who do you think you are, Mars? I mean, it's just so funny, those little things where he's just telling you facts and it's funny.
He just states the obvious as loud as he can. And he also knows the secret of quiet. When you get real quiet, how you draw people in. And then construction of things is amazing.
Oh, he's
the best opening joke, I thought, when he hosted SNL. After he'd gotten fired, and then they ended up bringing him back.
Right.
And he goes, yeah, so I got fired from this show for not being funny enough. So now I'm hosting it. So evidently, either I got a lot funnier or this show sucks. That's how he opened.
Then it occurred to me, I haven't gotten funnier. The show has gotten really bad. So, yeah, I'm funny compared to, you know, well, you'll see later.
In 1998, in January 7th, if you look it up, January 7th, 1998, he did the Letterman show. That is the day that he got fired from Weekend Update.
Right.
And he wouldn't say anything negative. Letterman did many, many times to him in his face. But he first of all, he was fired. He still showed up and did this appearance. You know, if you got fired off your main event, I doubt you would want to
promote it
and be out in public.
Right.
And that's all they talked about. And he would not say, you know, Letterman was going, what kind of idiot would fire you? No, he's a very nice man. He was a nice man. He just didn't like my, he would not besmirch the guy that made.
Class act.
The most classy.
Don Ohlmeyer.
Yeah.
I met him once and I was struck how nice he was. We didn't even introduce each other to each other, but he was just talking to me like we already knew each other. And I love guys like that. I love guys that just are already talking to you like they know you. And it made me feel very comfortable. And I looked up to him, and I still do. You know, he's passed, and it was a shock to the comedy world. Nobody knew really that he was struggling with cancer. And he, you know, he eventually lost a battle, but I look at it like he beat it for 9 years because, you know, people don't do that. But the guy was truly funny. He was a comics comic, but he was one of those comics comic that just breaks through to also the fucking the citizens and make them laugh just as much. I mean, the guy was just so special.
He's a fucking great guy.
He's my hero.
I love him to death.
Fun, maybe one of the funniest guys on the planet. Dave Attell, Norm, in that. There's something about those two.
National treasures.
I agree. And the fact that he's not like the biggest comic of all time is weird.
Well, he is to us.
I guess so.
To comics, I mean, he's not the biggest, but the comics, he's on. The Mount Rushmore keeps getting bigger.
It's I
not,
know.
Four
I
heads know. Is not a good enough amount.
You got to stop using that thing.
Yeah, it's a bad thing to say, the Mount Rushmore, but in the Hall of Fame.
Hall of Fame.
That's the thing.
There you go,
He's in the Hall of Fame.
He's like on another level where he's invented certain things I never knew. Like he's taken comedy to this higher point, which I didn't know existed.
Hmm.
I wish I could come up with an example.
He's another guy, too, that still does real comedy. Like when he goes on stage, he's fucking ballsy.
Yeah.
He swings.
Right.
You know, like,
right.
And he gets confused if everybody's mad. Like, what's happening?
Yeah.
Just a joke, yeah, folks.
He keeps it real. You don't have to pull this up because it's long, but there was a radio show, like a morning show, like you have to do on the road for press. And he's doing one and he's like, well, you know, black people, they're poor. And the lady is like, oh my God, how can you say that, Norm? That is so racist. He's like, I'm reading the newspaper. I'm watching the news. I'm looking at the stats. They're poor. And she's like, oh my God. And all these black women call in. They go, Norm's right. We're fucking poor. It sucks. And he's like, you see? It was such a great moment.
What radio show is this?
It's on YouTube. I don't know. It's just some dickless and jizz in the morning, you know, one of those things.
People don't like him doing things. When he was doing his Netflix show,
oh, yeah?
Someone specifically did not want him doing interviews because he got on the Howard Stern show and he wanted to say, well, if you think that way, you're fucking retarded.
Right.
But he didn't want to be offensive. So, well, you think that, you must have Down syndrome. He thought that'd be the better thing to say.
I guess it is.
I'm not sure.
Yeah.
And everybody started freaking out
that
he said that.
Right.
Instead, he thought he was like covering his tracks.
Right.
And so he couldn't do interviews after that.
Yeah, he's brilliant.
I said to him, one of the hardest parts about doing Update for me was not telling every joke the way I thought Norm would tell it. Like, I had to beat Norm's delivery out of me. It still sneaks in all the time, but I really had to keep an eye on it. And I told him how hard that part was to me, and he said, I'm so glad to hear you say that, because my son was watching you on Update and said to me, you talk like Seth Meyers. And he told me that when he said that, he said, oh no, my son doesn't know how time works.
The last time I talked to him, when I was quarantined in Minnesota, he would, I'd text him and I go, hey, what's up, dude? And he goes, what? Who's this? And he would do this all the time. I go, it's fucking Nick, dude. He goes, ah, Nicky, what are you doing? And I'm like, nothing, I'm quarantined. And he goes, you didn't stand up? And I'm like, no, the fuck? No one's doing stand-up. And he goes, what's your plan? And I go, I don't know. I'm going to kick it here, and then I think I'm going to go to Key West. And I go, I might just retire, though, and just move to Reno and just get, like, a residency. And then I'll just live in Reno and just work there, just be like an old comic.
Yeah.
And he goes, sort of God, he goes, that's a good idea. And I go, yeah, I don't know, whatever. He goes, maybe I'll join you. We'll both headline Reno. And I go, dude, Reno's fucking a mess. I go, no, I don't want to do it. So I go to Key West. A month later, he calls me. He goes, hey, what are you doing? And I go, I don't know. I'm in Key West. What's up with you? And he goes, when are you going to Reno? And I go, dude, that was a joke. I'm not moving to fucking Reno and retiring as like a comic. And he goes, ah, fuck. I thought it was a good idea. And I'm like, no. And so that's the last time I talked to him. And then his closest friend, Lori Jo, mm-hmm. I hit her up after Norman passed. And I was like, hey, are you doing okay? And she goes, one of the last things before Norm died, one of the last things he talked about was moving to Reno with you.
No.
Yeah. And I go, are you serious? She goes, yeah. He was like, he really wanted to do that. And I was like, oh, and then that made me cry again.
Norm was sick for quite a while, and he got sicker, and I didn't know. And I talked to so many people who I was sure knew. I thought maybe I'm the only one that doesn't know. And so many people, he didn't want anybody to know.
I didn't know.
And so, you know, being the self-absorbed person I am, I think a lot of us, we thought, is he mad at me? Is there something I did?
Sure.
'Cause we kept trying to get him to come back on. And we couldn't. He couldn't do it because I don't think he was up for it, and he didn't want to answer questions about maybe, you know, his appearance or anything. But I remembered when he went, everybody in the community was. We all thought we were the only one that didn't know, and we were so upset that we didn't get a chance to tell him what he meant to us. And then I very quickly realized he would not have tolerated that. He didn't want it. Right, he didn't want any of us to tell him.
He'd get grossed.
He'd get very unhappy.
Think treat him different or laugh.
Yeah,
at jokes.
You reflect on experiences you had with him during the time he was ill and wondered if that had manifested itself because of the illness.
Well, we have recorded this a few days earlier, so we've just discovered. Pardon my, I'm a little speechless.
Mm-hmm.
We just discovered that one of the best comedians of all time, Norm Macdonald, has died.
Yes, one of the funniest guys on the planet, one of my heroes, huge influence on me. I've seen everything. I watch his YouTube probably every other day. I just put it on.
When I first met you and I saw you, I was like, oh, he's doing like a Jerry Norm thing.
Yeah, completely.
Seinfeld and Norm. I think Attell and Dangerfield were my.
Yes.
Every comic you'd see, Joe Mackey was like Hedberg and Eugene Merman.
Wow.
You could always see who people were kind of influenced by in their
Definitely.
First couple years. And,
yeah.
And for you, it was Norm Macdonald.
Yeah, I just, I'm floored. I cannot believe this is real. I'm crushed. I'm hurt. My body's doing that thing where it keeps avoiding it. My brain keeps avoiding it, but then I have to remind myself that it's real.
Well, it's crazy to discover this literally maybe 3 minutes before we just recorded.
Yeah, a live stream ep, by the way. And, oh my God, I just one of those guys you just never thought this. I had no idea I had cancer.
He was very young. 61.
61.
Very young.
He had another special in him. He's great on podcasts. I just wish he made more. And I mean, look, he's got a lot of stuff out there. So I'm getting greedy. But I think he's one of the funniest people. I mean, no
ever.
One sounds like him. Amazing jokes. Great takes. Brilliant comic.
I believe Rosie O'Donnell was hosting SNL. And her very best friend, Penny Marshall, was there to support her. Penny Marshall, at the height of her movie director swag, is walking through the hallway with her head down, sunglasses on, baseball hat, doesn't want to be bothered, treating all these basically writers and NBC employees and me and Norm as big-timing us, pretending we're just looky-loos out on the street. Right? Just right. Doing a celebrity don't bother me moment.
Flyby.
Flyby. Thank you. And Norm picks up on it and he just starts pointing and screaming, Laverne! 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 And she didn't look up. She never knew it was Norm. She just gone.
Like I'll have fun on stories. I will post things on Twitter that are innocuous and read responses.
Yeah.
I don't get into the minutia, but they'll give me a heads up when I'm getting hit pretty hard.
Sure.
And they're like, just so you know, everyone's thinks it's a little insensitive that you didn't put up a Norm post yet. And I went, huh? I was like, so now you tell me that the mob gets to tell me how to grieve? Because I knew Norm.
Yeah. Also, it's like, I felt, I didn't, I just posted one of his jokes, but like,
I didn't want to post like I loved you or something like that. Like, because who the fuck am I? Well, like, I need to come out and be like,
it made me feel so gross to find a picture of him.
Yeah.
Screen grab it, post it, and then I wrote like 9 different things. And this is when I cried. So I'm in the house, I'm drinking a bottle of wine, and I'm voice texting when I said, and I started crying, and I went, oh fuck. Cause he was just like, he was so cool to me. Like, you know, when the thing he did that was the coolest thing that anyone can ever do is he knew my name.
Yeah.
Before he needed to. Like, he just went, Bert Kreischer.
Yeah.
Hey. Taking the shirt off tonight, are we?
Yeah.
And I go, oh, he knows who I am.
SNL 40th was a few years ago. I got to stand on stage with Colin Quinn and Kevin Nealon and Norm. And the SNL 40th was a night where everyone just got a couple things to say. There were so many people there, and it was really limited. And I remember the four of us each had a little thing to say. I believe memory serves before we introduced Chevy. I think that was the role we were serving. And I remember we all said our line, myself and Colin and Kevin, and then Norm just started talking. And none of it was what he was supposed to say. And Wally, you were holding the cards. And I will say, I haven't seen this much in my years with Wally, but you did a thing where you actually looked at the cards. In an effort to find, and I remember laughing really hard, not at what Norm was saying as much as the idea that any of us thought Norm would play by anyone else's rules on any night. He told me once that his favorite thing about SNL is you can still, it's the, like the last place on TV where you can bomb. And, you know, there's a warm-up comedian at the beginning of the night at SNL, usually a cast member or a writer. But the commercials, it's not like going to a sitcom taping or other tapings where anyone is trying to keep the energy up during the course of the show. And Norm said that was so great because by the time update rolled around, if the show was bad, you could literally just go out there and bomb. And that both made that level of difficulty something that I think he really respected. And also he loved, or I should say, he just didn't care if he was bombing. If he thought the jokes were good, he had exactly as much fun telling them to a dead audience than to one who appreciated them. And I think for so many of us, we came up watching Norm and we thought that you were on the inside with him when you were watching him tell these jokes that you thought were great and no one in the room thought was good. And you just felt this connection to him and that ability to just stare into an audience unblinkingly telling the jokes that that you believed in.
This is at a time where in New Jersey, if you weren't telling dirty nursery rhymes wearing a leather jacket, you weren't really interesting to anybody. But here's Norm, this goofy Canadian accent, really telling these long, weird bits for 8 shows. And he probably bombed 3 out of 8 shows. Whenever he killed, which was, he would kill, when it was a sophisticated crowd, he would get him and he would kill. He would just go backstage, he'd pull out a deck of cards, and he'd make me and Rich Voss play poker with him. When he bombed, Norm would go to the exit and say goodbye to every single person who left. Just to be weird and make us laugh and be awkward for the people. He would thank everyone for coming after he bombed.
Are you serious?
He was such a nut.
I love that. That's a committed person.
You asked for some stories about Norm MacDonald and Bob Saget. And the odd part about it is that if I had known they would die as young as they did, I would have really taken notes. I remember one time, like every time I had lunch with Norm, I would let him pay. I wouldn't put in a dime. And then one time we went out to lunch, and he waited for me to put at least a dollar in. And I said, come on, why ruin a tradition? And so he put the money in again. And I remember one time doing Norm's podcast, And it was like the two of us were just going crazy and laughing, and it was like insane. And then afterwards, we went to dinner, joined by Bob Saget and Jeffrey Ross. And that was like just nonstop laughing and joking. I mean, I think that dinner, if we had been secretly filmed, that would have been an award-winning comedy special. Yeah, so I still miss Norm and I still miss Bob. And I'm sure they're happy to have like fans like you who still remember them.
Hey to one of the great comedians of all time, and we love you, Norm.
You got that right. Big fan, hero. All right, Pete.